JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for May the 4th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher on Friday, and although it pulled back somewhat on Monday, it remained elevated against all the other G10 currencies. It advanced the most against NOK, NZD, Euro and CHF in that order, while it eked out the least gains versus the Canadian dollar. The greenback rally on Friday may have been the result of end-of-month portfolio rebalancing, with international investors perhaps loading up on US treasuries. Remarks by Dallas Fed President Robert Kaplan that he and his colleagues should start discussing about quantitative easing tapering may have also encouraged some dollar buying. However, Fed Chair Powell maintained a cautious stance, noting that the economy is doing better, but it is not out of the woods yet. Indeed, latest data support the notion. Yesterday, the ISM manufacturing PMI for April slid to 60.7 from 64.7 at the time when the forecast was for a rise to 65, warning participants not to be overly excited. Now, leaving the FX sphere and traveling to the equity world, we see that yesterday most major EU and US indices ended higher, perhaps due to European Commission's plans to loosen COVID-related restrictions on tourism, as well as largely upbeat earnings season. The exceptions were UK's FTSE 100, which stayed closed due to a bank holiday, and Wall Street's Nasdaq, which slid 0.48%, as investors have been rotating into cyclical and reopening stocks. Mega cap tech stocks, the likes of Amazon, Alphabet, Facebook, and Microsoft, traded south, despite reporting upbeat results last week. As for today in Asia, Japanese and Chinese markets were closed due to holidays. Otherwise, sentiment appeared to have remained supported. Both Hong Kong's Hang Seng and South Korea's KOSPI are up 0.83% and 0.61% respectively. Overall, we stick to our guns that with most economies around the globe now reopening due to the improving pace of the vaccination rollouts, the Fed's willingness to stay accommodative for longer, and US President Biden's pledge to pass more supportive bills, the broader market sentiment is very likely to stay supported. We believe that equity markets may continue trending north, while the US dollar and other safe havens like the yen may come under renewed selling interest. This could happen as early as this Friday when the US employment report is due to be released, with a forecast pointing to another round of stellar job gains. Now flying to Australia, today during the Asian trading, the RBA decided on monetary policy. As it was widely anticipated, the bank kept all its policy settings unchanged, repeating that the economic recovery in Australia has been stronger than expected and is forecast to continue. That said, officials added that despite the strong recovery, inflation pressures remain subdued in most parts of the economy, and thus, at the July meeting, they will consider future bond purchases following the completion of the second 100 billion Aussies purchases in September. This means that similarly to the Fed, the RBA is committed to stay extra loose for long, at least until actual inflation is sustainably within its 2-3% target, something they don't see happening until 2024 the earliest. In our view, the RBA's pledge to keep its policy loose in the years to come may be a relatively negative factor for the Aussie. However, the bank noted that the currency remains near the upper end of the range of recent years, which means that they are not too concerned about its value. With that in mind, we would consider the path of least resistance for this currency as indeed being to the upside. The extra loose monetary policy stances outside Australia as well, like in the US and the Eurozone, are likely to keep the broader market sentiment supported, and thus, as a risk-linked currency, the Aussie may benefit as well. Now, as for the rest of today's events, we have the final UK manufacturing PMI for April, which is expected to confirm its initial estimate, as well as the US and Canadian trade balances for March. The US deficit is forecast to have widened somewhat, while Canada's surplus is anticipated to have decreased. With regards to the energy market, we get the American Petroleum Institute report on crude oil inventories for last week, but as it is always the case, no forecast is available. Tonight, during the Asian session Wednesday, New Zealand's employment report for the first quarter is due to be released. The unemployment rate is forecast to have held steady at 4.9%, while the net change in employment is expected to have slowed to 0.2% quarter over quarter from 0.6%. The labor costs index is anticipated to have stayed unchanged at 1.5% year over year. At its prior gathering, the RBNZ kept its policy untouched, staying prepared to lower the official cash rate further if required, and adding that a prolonged period of time is most likely to pass before their objectives are met. Although the CPIs for the first quarter surprised to the upside, the year-over-year rate remained below the midpoint of the bank's target range of 1-3%, and thus, in our view, a slowdown in jobs growth will allow officials to remain ready to cut interest rates if deemed necessary. We also have one speaker on today's agenda, and this is San Francisco Fed President Mary Daly. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.